Dear students, let us start the discussion on today's newspaper, that is 22nd December 2017. The first article is A. Raja, Kanimuzi, all other accused, acquitted in 2G spectrum case. Now, here we have to understand what is this case is all about. In this, we will be touching about the functionings of CAG office, Comptroller and Auditor General, criminal justice system. In this, premier investigation agency CBI and its way of functioning. And after that, we also can look into the accountability issues in India, especially after neoliberal reforms. After 1991 reforms, how the accountability has changed, what are the challenges the traditional mechanisms of accountability are facing. From these three dimensions, we have to see this article. You know that the 2G spectrum case is about allocation of the valuable resource, natural resource, that is spectrum, across the telecom companies. Mr. Raja was the telecom minister and he has allocated the spectrum on first-come, first-served basis. In this, the rules are also said to be violated in giving the spectrum to Swan Telecom and Unitec Telecom. Now, first come, first serve basis is one thing, and the second is competitive bidding is another thing. Later, the things have shifted to the competitive bidding. The 3G spectrum and everything was through competitive bidding. So, what the auditor did is this. So, if the government has gone with the competitive bidding, how much is the revenue it would have gained? He has calculated that. It means, because of the first-come, first-served basis, there is a notional loss to the exchequer. It is not a real loss. It is a notional loss because the government did not make a right policy decisions to bid for that spectrum competitively. So, in this case, does it come under the scope of the CAG? So, the CAG has to estimate the expenditure, but he cannot involve with the policy decisions of the government. So that's why when Mr. Vinod Rai wrote, or when Vinod Rai reported about this, government of Manmohan Singh has objected to it, saying that it is a CAG activism. Now, on my table, I have this book, Not Just an Accountant, written by Mr. Vinod Rai itself. In this, he makes a detailed argument which is related to 2G spectrum case. What he says is that notional loss and also opportunity cost loss, these are the evolving trends in the West in estimating the losses met by the exchequer. So in India, lack of definition of this notional loss and opportunity cost loss to the government is making are giving a scope for discretion, whims and fancies of the people in the public office. That is what he is trying to convey over here. And there is one beautiful statement which he makes in this book, which you can use for essay. That is Benjamin Franklin's statement. What it clearly states, what he says is, if you would not be forgotten as soon as you are dead, either write something worth reading or do something worth writing. This is what is the statement. So, that is what is the premise on which he wrote the book. Okay, let's go back to this. And the second aspect is criminal justice system. So, how it runs? Let's understand this. First is an FIR will be filed. And after that, investigation goes on. And accused will be taken into custody. So, why the accused are taken into judicial remand? So the reason is to get the, or not to tamper with the evidences. And for a fair investigation, the accused are sent for judicial remand. And then after that, a charge sheet has to be filed by the investigator. So the charge sheet once filed, the case goes for the trial. So there are trial courts. Above that, you have the appeal courts, higher judiciary, high courts and supreme courts. So, in this case, the premier investigation agency in India is CBI. So, the CBI is also has become a regular investigation agency. With regard to the central government, Even the simple frauds are also being today inquired by the CBI. And CBI is often criticized as a caged parrot. And third thing is, CBI do not have the personnel of its own. Most of the officers in CBI, they come on deputation and they leave the institution. So that's why institutional loyalties are missing. And when the case goes for trial, prosecution is very much important. So the prosecution has to take up the case of investigator. So CBI do not have its own prosecution machinery. And most of these prosecutors, these are appointed by the government and these are temporary positions rather than permanent positions. And there is a lot of corruption involving over here with regard to public prosecutor is concerned. So, if criminal justice delivery system has to be improved, we have to improve the levels or competence of prosecution, and we also need to improve the competence of investigation. One biggest fault at the investigation level in India is to strengthen the case, police tries to create the evidence which is not existing. And they try to frame everyone possible so that the length and breadth of the case will increase. So more number of people are involved, more number of people are being brought into the charge sheet that is being considered as an effective investigation by police in India. So because of this, when the matters go to the court, obviously whatever the police have framed, the court will not take it into cognizance. It is going to weaken the case and weaken the prosecution argument. So the quality of investigation need to be improved. And then the CBI is a overburdened agency and CBI has multiple heads which are supervising it. Supreme Court, Home Ministry, CVC, all these are the heads who are supervising the CBI now. And CBI initially is an institution supposed to look into the cases of corruption. Now, it has become an agency for every case in India. So these are the things we need to understand with regard to CBI concern. After the neoliberal reforms have come up in India, the traditional accountability institutions such as CAG are facing a big challenge. So what they are doing is this. Now, new concepts of laws, cronyism, these are not being perfectly defined in the legal framework. So this legal vacuum is creating problem for their functioning. So these are the points which I like to mention with regard to this. Next article is GST, a work in progress. Now, Government of India has initiated GST, and GST is a progressive tax reform which was taken up by many countries across the world. More than 150 countries are implementing GST now. In this, as per IMF Structural Adjustment Program, one of the important suggestions is to shift towards the GST. The objective of GST is to create a simplified tax regime. So in this context, three points we need to see carefully. The first is, threshold for implementation of GST is supposed to be a bit higher. So let me put it this way. Threshold means the amount of turnover on which GST has to be made compulsory. In India, this threshold is as of now 20 lakh rupees. And if the threshold is improved to 50 lakh rupees, then there will not be a much loss to the exchequer, but many of the small traders will be kept out of this particular GST burden and the GST procedural issues. So many of the countries have kept GST threshold level at a significant higher position for the reason that it increases compliance and also decreases the work burden on the GST implementation machinery. And second aspect is the GST tax slabs have to be as minimal as possible. The best suggested are two tax rates. Now, for the common used goods, common man goods, regular used goods, lowest tax possible, and luxury goods, higher tax slab. So only two tax rates have to exist. If you take in India, as of now, four tax slabs and also three different kinds of cess, these are the part of it. So we need to redefine this. And third aspect, implementation has to be impeccable without any problems. So this implementation needs to be improved. So in India, these implementation issues have to be stabilized as much as possible. So with regard to the second point, the tax slabs have to be as minimal as possible for three different reasons. One is, many tax slabs exist, this ultimately leads to, bargaining from the traders and also influencing of the government. And second aspect is, multiple rates will lead to inverted duty structure. What is meant by this inverted duty structure? Let me say it this way. If I am importing a shirt from China, and if I am importing the raw material for making a shirt from China, the tax on raw material, if it is high, then the manufacturing cost in India is going to be high compared to the import of the shirt from China. So that becomes a disincentive to manufacturing in India. So that is the reason why we need to have only two tax slabs to avoid this. And finally, so in India, the GST implementation is facing many complexities which need to be solved as soon as possible. That is what this article emphasizes on. From owning a home to feeling at home. Remember this. In the world today, biggest humanitarian crisis, they emanate from lack of a state for citizens. I put it as this way. Stateless people, these face the huge violation of human rights. If you talk about Rohingyas in Myanmar and few of the Tamilians in Sri Lanka, these are the examples for stateless citizens. Let me put it, the perspective on Tamilians. When the people went to Sri Lanka to work in tea gardens, these people were supposed to be given certain basic amenities and citizenship, which Britishers then have ignored. Then later after independence, Sri Lanka also did not provide for the same. So that's why these people were subjected to exploitation. Now, the government of India is working closely with government of Sri Lanka to provide them with housing, health, education and other aspects of life to live with dignity, which is a welcome sign. So with regard to human rights issue, remember the word stateless people. And Austrian shift. You don't need to remember the names in this article, just what is happening in the Europe, try to understand. Islamophobia, disintegration of European Union, growth of right wing or extreme right parties in Europe. So these are going to destabilize the existing architecture of European Union. That's what the emphasis of this article is. So should adultery be a crime? So I have discussed this enough. Now, let us make a small revision of this. You know, section 497 of Indian Penal Code declares adultery as a punishable offense with the 5 years of imprisonment. So here, the first is, a man who is involved with adultery is seen as disturbing the sacrosanct institution of marriage, and he is also causing a harm to the husband of that particular woman. So here, the person who is expected to be a complainant is the husband. If husband approves with that particular relationship, then it do not come under the definition of adultery. Here the first is, if a married man is in relationship with an unmarried woman, then it do not come under the definition of adultery. And second, wife of this married man who is involved with adultery, she cannot become a complainant. Only the husband of the woman who is involved with adultery can become the complainant. So this has come from the European or Victorian laws, which are majorly based in Christian values. And second aspect is, it is discriminatory against women. Patriarchal notions are clearly visible in this section 497. And second is, across the world, The adultery is more becoming a civil offense, and it can be basis for divorce. So in India too, we can convert that into a civil offense. So these are the points we need to carry home over here. There is one more important article for a wider food basket. In India, we suffer from triple burden. What does that mean? Undernutrition plus overnutrition plus micronutrient deficiency, which is also called hidden hunger. Undernutrition, overnutrition, micronutrient deficiency. These three together, we call it as triple burden of India. What is the major reason for this? Excessive dependence on rice and wheat cereals and lack of focus on protein nutrition. These are the major reasons. It is giving rise to increased burden of non-communicable diseases. So what we are expected to do over here? The first thing is, we have to diversify our food basket. And second thing is, food fortification, biofortification. The essential micronutrients have to be fortified with largely consumed food. Iodine with salt is a typical example. So these things we need to remember over here. Now, and then, the Congress takes on government after 2G ruling. Now, 2G spectrum scam, it is a major issue in 2014 elections, and it can be stated as one of the reasons for remarkable loss of Congress. So, how popular perception with regard to the scam in India is a major issue. So, whenever a scam is said to have occurred, even before the judgment of the courts come up, people assume that it has happened in India. It is majorly for the reason that wide prevalence of the corruption. And the next, India-Russia working closely on Afghanistan. You know that India is trying to supply Mi-35 helicopters to Afghanistan. So Russia is going to cooperate with India in supply of these particular helicopters. India-China border talks today. So you know the 20th round of border talks are going between the special representatives, and it is the first meeting after the Doklam standoff between these special representatives. One more issue which is coming into focus is the Siang issue. It is a tributary of Brahmaputra, and this is a very polluted river. And this pollution is carried forward into Brahmaputra, which is essential for livelihood in India and Bangladesh. And then, in the last page, I gave you the notes which will be available to you at laics.in/CivilsPrep. So, by next week, I think CivilsPrep will be revamped. The speed of the website will be increased. Thank you very much and all the best.